Well, good morning, everyone. It is good to be here with you, worshiping and growing together. And thank you to everyone who's here watching, listening with us online. Today, we are wrapping up our series about how following Jesus involves more than just liking Jesus. We've covered topics like having the heart of a servant and how to deal with idols and how to deal with failure. And today, we are concluding with the topic of holiness, that following Jesus involves a call to holiness. There are two questions that are important to answer at the start of this. The first being, what is holiness according to the Bible? The second being, why is it something that I would want to pursue? And these questions are interlinked. And the reason that I think sometimes we have a hurdle to holiness is because our caricature of a holy person exists in what I call the holy bubble. And what that means is we think of the holy person first and foremost as a rule follower, which is not necessarily wrong. And we think of them second as set apart, which is also not necessarily wrong. But we think of the holy person as set apart from anything that is unholy, which is not just sin, but also includes unholy people. And so we end up with the holy bubble, which is the person who is isolated and exclusive and distant from the rest of the world because they don't want to be infected by anything or anyone who could be viewed as unholy. But the difficult question that we have to ask ourselves that I want to start with this morning, if we look at holy as the holy bubble, if our holy person is exclusive and distant from unholy people, then what does that say about our view of a holy God? See, our holy person, our holy bubble, isn't actually based on God's character. We take a concept that's based on God and we try to apply it to our own rules, and we end up afraid of anyone who doesn't follow those rules, that we might end up like they are. But biblical, godly holiness, the holiness that's based in his character, the holiness that's shown to us through the life of Jesus is this: set apart, incorruptible, in morality and purity. We're gonna look at a text that talks about holiness today. It is set apart in morality and in purity. And when I say morality, what I'm referring to is the actions that we take as individuals. But when I talk about purity, we're talking about the motives behind those actions, because you may have seen that people are capable of doing good things for a bad reason. And oftentimes, people with the best motive are capable of doing bad things. So to be biblically holy, as God is holy, is to not allow either our actions or our motives to be polluted or corrupted. So biblical, godly holiness, then, doesn't fit in the holy bubble because it's not exclusive or distant from unholy people. It's not condemning of the sinner, but on the contrary, the holiness of God is perfect in action and in motive towards the sinner. So he steps outside of the holy bubble. And so biblical holiness, as God is holy, leaves us with a difficult question to answer. And that's what we're going to explore today. Our passage is 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16. It's on the screen for you. It says this: "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.'" So again, holiness in this passage is referring to being set apart, being pure, uncorrupted, in actions and in motives, in morality and in purity. And the qualifier of this statement is what makes it impossible. As he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do. If God is the standard of action and motives, then the standard is perfection. And this is a problem for us because last I checked, I am not a perfect person. And actually, I contribute to the sin of the world on a fairly regular basis. I mean, can I get a show of hands? Does anybody consider themselves to be perfect in motive and in action? Some of you are about to raise your hands, and the person next to you pushed it back down for you this morning. So we can't be holy as God is holy because we have sin in our hearts. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if we've fallen short, then we're left with this impossible command to be holy as God is holy. And so we have to choose how we respond to that command. And this morning, I want to look at four responses to the call to be holy. And the reason that I want to look at these responses is because I think we see tendencies towards each of these responses in us. I have stories for most of these as the times when I have responded in these ways to the call to be holy. And what I want you to know is that there will be tough questions to ask yourself in this message. But not only are those questions necessary, but there will be hope at the end of this message. And that's my promise to you if you're willing to kind of take this journey with me. So, four responses to the call to be holy, and I want to look specifically at the fruit of our lives, that is the results of the way that we live according to each response. So the first call to be holy as God is holy is what I call the defeatist. And the perspective is, if I cannot achieve, then I give up. When I was in eighth grade, I took tech class, and we had these things called circuit boards where you were supposed to connect these wires, and at the end of it, if you did it correctly, a light bulb would light up. And you were supposed to complete a certain number of circuit boards by the end of the semester. And what I discovered was that I did not have a future as an electrician. Because try as I might, my lab partner and I struggled through these circuit boards, and I would connect all the wires exactly as I thought they should be. And at the end of the day, the light bulb simply would not turn on. So I got to this point kind of later in the semester where I realized that there was too many circuit boards left for me to possibly finish them on time. But I knew that I was a good enough student that I was going to pass the class regardless of whether or not I finished my circuit boards. So I just took the L, as the young people say, and moved on. So the defeatist perspective is, if the task is impossible, then why am I trying? Why try to grow in holiness if I know that I'm not going to experience the completion of that on this side of eternity? Why not just take my bad grade in this class and move on? Because again, isn't my justification found in Jesus? And that's true. We are saved by grace through faith. But what the defeatist response misses, what you miss when you say, if I cannot achieve, then I give up, is that over the course of the life of Jesus, he ate with tax collectors who then turned and followed him. And he blessed prostitutes who broke perfume and used their hair to wash his feet. And he revealed his divine identity to a woman who had been married 5 times and was living with a man who was not her husband. And then she turned and found everyone that she could and told them to go back and see this man who had told her all about herself. And they came and they believed him. The defeatist misses that holiness is not just about you. Holiness is not just about you. Holiness serves the purpose of expanding the kingdom of God and making great the name of Jesus and making disciples of Jesus. So if you are the defeatist, then you will. You might pass the class, but you're going to miss God at work. And so the fruit of the defeatist, the fruit of the perspective of if I cannot achieve holiness, then I'll give up on holiness, is selfishness and purposelessness. Because lurking behind the response of the defeatist is the belief that expanding the kingdom of God and making disciples of Jesus is not a goal worth pursuing. And this leaves you without a purpose outside of caring about yourself. So the defeatist then experiences life as unfulfilling and stagnant. And this is my first difficult question for us this morning. Do you feel like you are unfulfilled in your life right now? Do you feel like you are not growing as an individual? And if that is true, ask yourself the difficult question today. Have you stopped looking for a purpose beyond yourself? Have you stopped looking for a way to serve others? And if this morning you're a follower of Jesus, have you stopped looking for ways to serve and speak and act towards others that would point them to Jesus? Have we missed our purpose? So there's caution in the perspective of the defeatist and selflessness and purposelessness, but there's also a glimpse in the shadow of that perspective of real holiness, which we realize that actual holiness must involve a purpose beyond serving ourselves. So the defeatist, if I cannot achieve, then I give up. The second perspective I want to talk about today is the moralist, which is if I cannot achieve, then I try harder. When I was in, I was a college football player, and specifically I played quarterback. And I have this distinct memory of one of my coaches coming to me and telling me that I needed to be perfect for the sake of our team. And I probably took his words too literally, but in that moment for me, a perfect goal was set. A standard had been set for me that I needed to achieve. And so I worked and I tried and I dug inside of myself to try to achieve that standard. And every day I dug down to find the best version of what I called football me. And what happened was I failed. And then I failed again. And then I failed again. And it crushed me. And every day I woke up in the morning and I didn't even want to get out of bed because I knew that no matter how hard I tried and no matter how hard I dug down inside of myself, I wasn't going to be good enough to meet the standard. And I had tried and I had tried and I'd strived and I dug down inside of myself, but I couldn't do it. So the moralist responds to the call of God to be holy with actions that are driven by dedication without grace. You dig down to be a better version of me. I dig down to get to where, to be who I want to be. Or just as often, I dig down inside of myself to be better so that I can stop being the version of myself that I am right now. So that I can stop seeing the things that I don't like. But what we have to see in this is that dedication without grace grows the fruit of anxiety and shame. Because when you fail, and you will, there's no grace to catch you. There's just your thoughts to push you down farther. And for anyone who has experienced this dedication without grace, you know that that anxiety and that shame is a weight that is incapacitating. So this is the second difficult question. If you wake up every day right now in a state of anxiety, or if you are ashamed of who you are, but you feel trapped and you feel like you will never change, ask yourself this difficult question today. Have you accepted the grace that says that even though you will never be enough, there's a God who is willing to send his son to die on a cross in your place so that the gap between you and perfection could be filled and you are already justified? Have you accepted the grace that says that you are enough in God's eyes because of what Jesus did? So we see the defeatist, which is if I cannot achieve, then I give up. We see the moralist, which is if I cannot achieve, I'll try harder. And we see that within the moralist, within the shadow of the moralist, once again, actual holiness must be deeply tied to grace. They are tangled together. And so in order to pursue real holiness, we also have to have a deep understanding of grace. And the third perspective that I want to look at is the individualist. And this is the perspective that if I cannot achieve, then I will change the goal. Show of hands, are there any avid readers this morning? People who really like to read? Okay. So I've gotten into reading again in the last couple of years. Have you ever read a book and you really like it and you're so excited and then they make a major motion picture out of that book and you get so excited and you go to the theaters and you sit there and you watch it and you're like, is this the same book that I read? Like, I feel like there's a disconnect between these two things. I read a book this past year that I really liked and then I watched the movie afterwards and in the end of the book, the main character dies. And in the end of the movie, the main character lives. And I was like, there's gotta be some sort of disconnect between these two things. They've come so far from what was originally the intent of this book. And so the individualist says, if I cannot achieve, then I'll change the goal. And this is actually a prevalent perspective in our society and even in the church as a whole right now, because the danger of this is that it's disguised at its onset. We don't set out with the goal to change what holiness is. But what happens to the individualist is that at some point in your pursuit of a relationship with God, you realize that there's something about the God described in the Bible that doesn't sit right with you. So there's something about a standard that he sets for us or an action that he takes. And in the back of your mind, this thought creeps in and you're like, I actually think the Bible got that wrong. I actually think that there's a flaw in the design here. And so you can write that first thing off as, well, things have changed since the Bible was written. It's an old book. But in the back of your heart, in the back of your mind, behind the scenes, there is now a crack in the perfection of God. And the danger of a crack in the perfection of God is that if God is not perfect, then God is no better than you. So the first step for the individualist then is to change one aspect of what it means to be holy as God is holy. Because there's something about the God in the Bible or the actions of Jesus or the commands to the church that doesn't fit with the way you think. So you adapt that one thing. But then once you've adapted that one thing, there's something else that you look at, that you see, that you read, and you think that also doesn't seem like it's right. And then there's another crack in the perfection of God. And gradually what happens to us is that the goal of holiness changes as the image of God changes. And so what we end up with is that we've changed the materials of who God is. We have the foundation, but the materials with which we build the house of God has now changed. And the problem with the individualist perspective is that when you create followers of God as the individualist, what you are actually creating is followers of you. Because the image of God has now changed to reflect your image. And we've changed the materials again with which we're building on the foundation of what Christ did for us. God's image has been distorted and manipulated not to reflect his words, but to reflect yours. And you're not perfect. I'm not perfect. That's how this whole thing started. So the difficult question we have to ask is, what happens when you build your faith, your life, with the wrong materials? This is 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 13. It's on the screen as well. And it says this: for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. If what has been built survives, the builder will receive a reward. If it is burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though only as one escaping through the flames. So this is the difficulty of the individualist, is that the fruit, the result of the life of the individualist, is manipulation and destruction. Because when you build a faith on a God who has your motives and who lines up with all of your actions, that faith is eventually revealed as a cheap knockoff manipulation of the actual perfect character of God. And it will be destroyed. Jesus promises us before he left on earth, he said, in this world you will have trouble. And trouble reveals things. Adversity reveals. So the difficult question for you to ask this morning at the end of this individualist is, if you feel like the world is crashing down around you right now and God is nowhere to be found, then you need to ask, who is God in your life? Is the unchanging creator of the universe, who is just and merciful and the giver of every good gift, is that your God? Or is your God actually just a mirrored reflection of your own evil desires? So there's caution in the individualist. There's caution in the perspective of, if I cannot achieve holiness, then I will change the goal of holiness. And again, in the shadows of that response, we see a glimpse of what real holiness must be, which is that real holiness involves knowing and believing a holy God in his entirety. So remember when I talked about hope? You guys probably forgot about that. It probably hasn't seemed too hopeful so far. But Remember when I talked about hope? We've looked at the defeatist. If I cannot achieve, then I give up. We've looked at the moralist. If I cannot achieve, then I'll try harder. We've looked at the individualist. If I cannot achieve, then I'll change the goal. And now we see the response that God craves. In Luke chapter 19, there's a story about a man named Zacchaeus. And I'm not going to read it in its entirety today. I'm going to summarize. But if you want to take a look at it, you can. It's in Luke chapter 19. Zacchaeus is what I would call the template of the unholy person. Remember when we talked about the bubble at the beginning and how it keeps you separate from unholy people? This was a man who, for his career, cheated people out of their money on the regular. So if we want to talk about the evil desires of mankind, he is the template of the unholy person. He is the template of the person that our holy bubble would avoid. But what happens in the story of Zacchaeus is that so he's a shorter man, which always gets harped on in the children's songs, but that's not the point of the story. So he's a shorter man, and Jesus is walking by, and so he climbs up in a tree to be able to see Jesus. And Jesus, as he's walking by, looks up at him, and he says, Zacchaeus, come down from the tree. I'm coming to your house, and we're going to eat together. And there's this one interaction, this one encounter with Jesus, and Zacchaeus takes it, and he comes down from the tree, and they go and they eat together. And then at the end of that encounter, Zacchaeus turns to Jesus and he says, look, Lord, I give away right now half of my possessions to the poor, and anyone who I have cheated out of anything, I will pay back four times what I have cheated from them. Zacchaeus is the template of the unholy person. Everything about him is driven by money. And this one interaction with Jesus is enough to leave him in a place where he says, I will give all of that away to follow this. So God's actual holiness is captured in this story. Because the same holiness that sets God apart from sin in his motives and in his actions is the same holiness in him that welcomes the sinner. The same holiness that says that he cannot do or think anything horrible, anything corrupt, is the same holiness that says, I see you, sinner, in that tree. Come down. I'm coming to be with you. And that's what changes the heart of Zacchaeus. So the follower says, if I cannot achieve, then I draw near. You see, the first three responses see this verse in 1 Peter as a be holy or else. They're driven to selfishness and manipulation and purposelessness and anxiety and shame and destruction. But the follower sees be holy as an invitation to be with the God who is actually perfect in action and an invitation and in purity and who gives every good gift and who is trustworthy in every way and who says, sinner, come down here. I want to be with you. The follower sees be holy as an invitation to be with holy. And what we see with Zacchaeus is that just being around Jesus' holiness, just answering the call to go be with Jesus is enough to draw the sinner into loving Jesus. And loving Jesus is what makes the sinner become like Jesus. 1 Peter chapter 2, we started in 1 Peter chapter 1. And right after that, in the very next chapter, verses 4 and 5, this is also on the screen, says this. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So holiness is laid out for us in this passage in the person of Jesus. He is the answer to the defeatist because he's the one who gave himself up to the people who rejected him so that he could become the cornerstone of their faith. He is the answer to the moralist because he's the one who qualifies our sacrifices, who qualifies our lives before God as acceptable through grace. And he is the answer to the individualist because he is chosen and precious before a perfect God. And he's the only foundation that won't give way when the troubles of the world come. I'm going to invite the worship team to come out at this point. I love Peter's verbiage in 1 Peter chapter 2. He says, as you come to him, the living stone. This is not a past tense, as you came, because you came, now this is happening. This is a present tense, if-then statement. As you come to the living stone, as you come to the picture of perfect holiness, you also are being built up like a living stone into a spiritual house. This is the process that we refer to as sanctification, which is the more you experience Jesus, the more you come to him and see his goodness and his glory and his love, the more you will become like him. So just like Zacchaeus, when you encounter Jesus, when you respond to Jesus, when you come to Jesus, and not just when you come, but when you come again and again into the presence of Jesus, you can't help but become like him. You can't help but want to follow him. Zacchaeus was consumed by every evil desire that's talked about in the first Peter chapter 1. He was consumed by his evil desire, but it was encountering Jesus that expelled that evil desire in order for it to be replaced by something better. Thomas Chalmers says this, the only way to dispossess the heart of an old affection is by the expulsive power of a new one. We as sinners, everyone in this room, has evil desires inside of us. And it might be a money lust for you like it was for Zacchaeus, but it could also be a lust for anything, for power, for sex, for the lust to be loved, to be looked at, to be approved by humanity. We have evil desires in us. And just like Zacchaeus, those desires are not expelled by our desire to be good or our desire to not be bad. They're expelled by loving something better. They're expelled when we respond to Jesus' invitation to come to him over and over and over again until just gradually our lives begin to look like his character. So the fruit of the follower is a relationship with Jesus. And the fruit of a relationship with Jesus is holiness. And not holiness and exclusivity and judgment, not holiness in the holy bubble, but holiness set apart from the sin of the world in that it lives off of every word of the mouth of the living God, but not separate from the sinners of the world. Instead, driven to love those sinners, to say, hey, sinner, come eat with me so that you might see my good deeds, you might see my love for you, and glorify my Father in heaven. It doesn't start with us being better or not being worse. It starts with us coming to Jesus over and over and experiencing him. So where do we go from here? What's our action step? What's our next step in pursuit of holiness? You've heard these things before, but I want you to look at them this morning with this new invitation from Jesus that says, come to me if you want to be holy. How do we know Jesus? The first step is read your Bible. Instead of reading it as a chore or a task to be checked off, look at it as you are learning who God actually is according to his own words. You are responding to the invitation of Jesus to come to him, and you're learning, you're gaining a new best friend, and the more that you learn, the more you're gonna fall in love. And if you get stuck, if you're like, why did God do this thing? Instead of tweaking that thing in your mind to fit what you think he should have done, ask a pastor in this church. There's nothing that we love more than talking about the God who is holy, who is described in scriptures. Try to view scripture as knowing and loving Jesus through your reading. Then you can apply the words of life to your work and your relationships, because you'll not just know the words, but you'll know the person behind them. So read your Bible, pray. Not out of obligation, but pray believing that God wants to hear you and does hear you, and that whether you receive the answer that you wanted or not, a perfectly holy and good God knows you, and he cares deeply about you, and he wants you to come to him. And if he wants you to come to him with everything, then pray bold prayers. Ask for his holy will to be done on earth, and worship. Not because you feel like singing or because something good happened to you, but the more you see how holy God is, the more you come before Jesus, the more you will want to fall down and say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. How we will spend eternity, holy is the Lord. And not just on Sundays. Worship is a commitment to living your life in loving and praising God at all times. So when you feel like worshiping God, lift your hands and lift your passion to Him. And when you don't feel like worshiping God, lift your faith, knowing that He is still holy. And I'm gonna invite you to stand. We're going to worship again together here. You see, the holiness of Jesus, the holiness of the God that we worship today says, I see you, sinner, and I want to be with you. And as we come to Him again and again, we are becoming more like Him in our actions and in our motivations. We are becoming holy, not set apart from the sinners of the world, but set apart from the sin of the world. So let's praise in sincerity. Let's pray without ceasing. And let's know God like we know no one else. Would you worship, church?